This is the demonstration to show that if the same force is applied on a heavier mass and a lighter mass, the lighter mass will have larger acceleration and heavier mass will have smaller acceleration. Here one should take care that we have to apply the same force. To take care of it, I have taken a car which runs with the spring force. The front wheel of the car is at the zero of the scale. Now I will move it to 10 and I leave it. Let me do once again. I have taken a car, I moved it up to 10 and then I left it. Now the car is stopped and it moved slowly. Now I will take out this mass that is placed. Now let's watch. Remember, we have to apply the same force. That means I have to stretch it again up to 10. It is obvious, you would have observed that the car gains larger acceleration. So, which clearly indicates that if you apply the same force, it produces smaller acceleration in heavier masses and larger acceleration in lighter masses. After watching the demonstration, we can conclude that if the same force is applied on two objects of one heavier mass and one lighter mass, the lighter mass can get change in velocity more and the change in velocity in the heavier mass is less. So the force is related to mass. So that is the first conclusion. Now let's do another demonstration. From our day-to-day life experiences, we are aware that if you want to increase the velocity of any object, then you have to increase the force. That can be demonstrated with the help of this car, which runs with the spring. Now, if I wind the spring for smaller windings, then it moves with smaller velocity, and if I wanted to make it to move with larger velocity, I have to wind the spring inside more. That means I am increasing the spring force so that it brings lot of change in velocity. So first let me show it to you by winding little. So this is the velocity. Now the same once again. So in the second case, you would have seen that the car was moving with larger velocity. With the two demonstrations, the very first demonstration has given the result that if the force is same, then if the object's mass is more, the rate of change of velocity will be lesser. The same force is applied on a lighter object, then it moves faster. That means the rate of change of velocity will be more. We know that rate of change of velocity is nothing but acceleration. So the first case we have proved by taking lighter vehicle and we have applied the same force, and later on we have kept some weight on it and then we have applied the same force, and we have seen that the heavier mass will move with little acceleration and lighter mass will move with more acceleration when the force is kept constant. So The force depends on mass. Now, in the second case, we have increased the force, the acceleration is increased. When we have taken lesser force, the acceleration was not that much. So, force is related to velocity. If an object is at rest, if you want to bring more velocity, you have to apply more force. If you want to bring less velocity, you have to apply less force. So, the force is connected with the two terms, mass and velocity. Newton has given a special name for the combined term, mass and velocity. That is only known as momentum. With the two demonstrations, the very first demonstration has given the result that if the force is same, then if the object's mass is more, the rate of change of velocity will be lesser. The same force is applied on a lighter object, then it moves faster. That means the rate of change of velocity will be more. We know that rate of change of velocity is nothing but acceleration. So, the first case we have proved by taking lighter vehicle and we have applied the same force, and later on we have kept some weight on it and then we have applied the same force and we have seen that the heavier mass will move with little acceleration and lighter mass will move with more acceleration when the force is kept constant. So, the force depends on mass. Now, in the second case, we have increased the force, the acceleration is increased. When we have taken lesser force, the acceleration was not that much. So, force is related to velocity. If an object is at rest, if you want to bring more velocity, you have to apply more force. If you want to bring less velocity, you have to apply less force. So, the force is connected with the two terms, mass and velocity. Newton has given a special name for the combined term, mass and velocity. That is only known as momentum. It is defined as the product of mass and velocity. It is represented by P. It is a vector quantity. When we say that it is vector quantity, immediately you must say the direction of it. The direction of momentum is always in the direction of velocity. Now, what could be the SI unit for it? As it is the product of mass and velocity, for mass we write kg and velocity meter per second. Therefore, kg meter per second is the unit of the momentum. The mathematical definition of momentum is the product of mass and velocity. It is a vector quantity. The direction of P is in the direction of velocity. The SI unit is kg meter per second. Some textbooks will write kg meter s minus 1. What does it tell us? The momentum gives us the information of the quality of the motion. Now let us revisit some of the events that happen in everyday's life. Suppose somebody is hit by a tennis ball. It does not hurt him. But in case of tennis ball, if you have taken a football, then certainly it hurts him. Now, if a truck which is moving at even 5 meter per second hits a person, can kill him. Similarly, if a bullet, if it is fired from a gun, it can kill the person. Suppose if the car is stopped somewhere because of dead battery, then what we do? We take the help of some people. So if somebody, one or two, hits this or gives some amount of force, then the car would not be starting itself. So what they have to do? They have to continuously apply the force for some time. Then only it can work or it can run. By observing all these events, we can say that the momentum, that is the product of mass and velocity, is working behind this. And here we can say that because of this momentum, the persons are getting hurt, or the impact on the person is depending. That is, if the more, if you want to create more impact, more momentum. So now, what actually we wanted to see, if we create, or we rather give more velocity to any object, then its momentum is also more, and it can give larger impact. So who can raise this velocity more? The agency is nothing but force. So this force is related to momentum. Now from all these examples, we can conclude that the change of momentum with time is directly proportional to the external force. That is only second law. So how can you state the second law? The rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the external force applied, or the force applied on the object. So F is directly proportional to the rate of change of momentum. That is, change of momentum divided by time. So this is the statement of second law of Newton's laws of motion. Now let us revisit some of the events that happen in everyday's life. Suppose somebody is hit by a tennis ball. It does not hurt him. But in case of tennis ball, if you have taken a football, then certainly it hurts him. Now, if a truck which is moving at even 5 meter per second hits a person, can kill him. Similarly, if a bullet, if it is fired from a gun, it can kill the person. Suppose if the car is stopped somewhere because of dead battery, then what we do? We take the help of some people. So if somebody, one or two, hits this or gives some amount of force, then the car would not be starting itself. So what they have to do? They have to continuously apply the force for some time. Then only it can work or it can run. By observing all these events, we can say that the momentum, that is the product of mass and velocity, is working behind this. And here we can say that because of this momentum, the persons are getting hurt, or the impact on the person is depending. That is, if the more, if you want to create more impact, more momentum. So now, what actually we wanted to see, if we create, or we rather give more velocity to any object, then its momentum is also more and it can give larger impact. So, who can raise this velocity more? The agency is nothing but force. So, this force is related to momentum. Now, from all these examples, we can conclude that the change of momentum with time is directly proportional to the external force. That is only second law. So how can you state the second law? The rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the external force applied, or the force applied on the object. So F is directly proportional to the rate of change of momentum. That is change of momentum. Divided by time. So this is the statement of second law of Newton's laws of motion. Now let us derive an expression for force. Let's consider an object of mass m kg, initial velocity with u meter per second, reaches the final velocity v meter per second in time t seconds. Now, what we have to do is, we have to first calculate initial momentum. So, initial momentum is equal to m times u. That is, we know that the definition of momentum is mass into velocity. We wanted to calculate initial momentum. Therefore, initial velocity times mass. This is p initial. Now, the final momentum. So that is mv, which is p final. Now let's calculate change of momentum. That is p final minus p initial, which you can write it as mv minus mu, which can be written as m into v minus u. Now, rate of change of momentum. That is m into v minus u by t. But we know that rate of change of velocity is acceleration. Therefore, I can write it as ma. According to second law, the rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the force. So, the rate of change of momentum is here is m into a, which implies F is equal to some constant into MA. Proportionality sign, what's the meaning of it? Suppose if two quantities are there, X is directly proportional to Y if you write. If there is an increment in Y, there should be the increment in X also. So, X is directly proportional to Y. So, suppose if y is reduced, x should also be reduced. That is called directly proportionality. If you say inversely proportional, if y is increased, x is decreasing. If y is decreasing, x is increasing, then we call it as inversely proportional. Anyway, here it is f is directly proportional to ma and f is equal to some constant into mass into acceleration. Now, here we have to define the Newton. We have already discussed what is Newton. Newton is the SI unit of force. So, 1 Newton can be defined as, this is the definition of Newton. Newton is the unit of force. It is the force required to produce 1 meter per second square acceleration in 1 kg substance. So when I put the values here, 1 newton is equal to k 1 kg and 1 meter per second square acceleration. Here everything is 1 except k. Therefore, the value of k must be equal to 1. Therefore, final formula for the force will be F is equal to, in place of k, if I put 1, F is equal to ma. This is the formula for the force. So in this we have simply taken the initial momentum, then final momentum, we calculated the change in momentum, and then subsequently rate of change of momentum, and then finally we have, this is what, this is according to, how can you write this, F is directly proportional to ma, that is from Newton's second law. From Newton's second law, you can write F is directly proportional to rate of change of momentum, which is nothing but ma. And to remove this proportionality sign, we have to multiply it by a constant. And Newton has cleverly defined the unit of force as, it is the force required to produce 1 meter per second square acceleration in 1 kg substance. So F is equal to ma is the final formula for the force. Now let's talk about the second law in everyday life. Now I gave some 4 questions here. 1. Why a cricketer drags his hands while catching a ball? Second question, why do we prefer cushioned bed to a cement bed in high jump? What is the role of shock absorbers in vehicles? Why a tomato or egg breaks whereas a tennis ball bounces back? In fact, the answer for all these questions is same. How? Let's consider in each case the mass of the object as m and the velocity with which it comes is u, and then the final velocity in all the cases it is 0. Now we know that the force is equal to rate of change of momentum, that is m times change in velocity by time. Now if you look at this formula, here m is same, you cannot change the mass of the object, you cannot change the velocity, anyway you are intended to stop it, or rather you want to make its final velocity as 0. So therefore the change in velocity is same. Suppose if the ball comes with 5 meter per second, the change in velocity will be minus 5. Because final velocity is 0, initial velocity is 5. So 0 minus 5. Now, only the thing is you can manipulate here is time. If you drag your hands while catching the ball in the first case, what happens? The time is increased. when the hands are dragged then what happens? The time is increased. Therefore, as the time is in the denominator, force will be reduced, because of which the impact is reduced. I hope it's clear. Force is equal to mass into change in velocity by time. Here, the numerator cannot be changed because it's not in our hands. You can neither change the mass of the ball nor you can change the change in velocity. Why? Because anyway you wanted to catch it. So the final velocity in every case it should be zero. The initial velocity, whatever the velocity that it comes with, that initial velocity is there already associated with the ball. Only thing is you can drag the time. So if you increase the time, then force will be reduced. If you abruptly catch the ball, the time is very less, therefore force will be more, therefore the impact will be more. Your hands get hurt. Now suppose if you are dragging your hands, that means you are increasing while catching the ball, the force is automatically be reduced because as t is increased. Now in the case of high jumper cushioned bed, what happens when he lands on the bed? The cushioned bed will go down and then gradually it comes back to its original position. Whereas cement bed will abruptly make him to zero velocity. The final velocity becomes zero very quickly. Therefore, change of velocity as t is smaller, f becomes more. Now, next, the same is the case in the shock absorbers. So suppose somebody goes over the bumper, then first of all, if the vehicle is having shock absorbers, first of all the spring action will go down and then gradually it comes up. So rate of change of momentum is reduced when time is increased. Now in the case of tomato or egg, the two things will come to rest when they hit the floor, and they will be broken into pieces. Now the thing is, why not this tennis ball? Because tennis ball is an elastic body, so when it hits the floor, then it compresses itself and then gradually it comes back to its original position. Therefore, it takes some time. Therefore, the time is increased, the force the impact on the ball is reduced. So for all these questions, the answer is same. Force is equal to m delta v by t. When t is increased, then automatically f is decreased, impact is also reduced. We define a new term f times t. If t goes to this side, f times delta t is called impulse. So this impulse is nothing but m delta v, because t goes to this side means m delta v. That is, change in momentum and impulse are same. We know that change in momentum is having kg meter per second. Now for impulse we write conveniently f delta t. For f it's newton, for t it is second. Newton second is the unit. These two quantities, even though they are numerically equal, but those two quantities are different. So impulse can be defined as the force applied for short interval of time. This impulse, the force applied for short interval of time. F delta t. So these are the some of the examples which can be explained by using the second law. Now There are lot many examples that you will come across in our day-to-day life. Only the thing is, you should understand the concept properly, then you can easily apply it to any unknown or new situation. Knowing is everything. If you are able to apply your knowledge that is learnt in four walls in day-to-day events, then only your education is said to be fruitful. Otherwise, it's mere waste.